Suresh, thank you so much for joining me today. How are you doing?
Not bad at all. My pleasure to be here with you.
It's actually my pleasure, I think. So let's talk about traditional risks that have come back into the front light in this past year. Things like credit risk have heightened. What are the new or renewed challenges in this area?
See, the impact of the pandemic is still being measured, and the actual impact will not be felt for another 12 to 18 months, when the full force of its devastation will be felt by not just the financial institutions, but by the real economy as well. So, given that backdrop, the amount of regulation that has been piled on, particularly in the area of credit and credit risk assessment, is staggering. And it is also frightening in the sense that this is a time when banks, financial institutions must be encouraged to not just lend to keep the economy buoyant, but also to ensure that they play a role in the rebuilding process. And this is not the time to block them. And the UK has done a lot in terms of bounce back loans and similar instruments. But at the same time, the number of regulations have also, to a certain extent, hamstrung the financial institutions. And this would create a challenge in the sense that traditional profitability and profit-making mechanisms are being squeezed.
So we're talking about regulations already, and after a crisis like this, I think a lot of people are speculating that we will see another onslaught of new regulations coming in. So is history repeating itself at the moment?
It has already started to. After 2007, 2008, the global financial crisis, the amount of regulation that was proposed and implemented by regulators worldwide and globalized regulations were at a heightened state. And I see a scenario playing itself out, which is very, very similar to that. The unfortunate fact is that at this time, a natural calamity, a disaster, is creating a catastrophe. Whereas in 2007, 2008, we were very much to blame, and we couldn't point the fingers at anybody else except ourselves. Whereas here, with the pandemic, we are at the receiving end, rather unjustly so, I would think, with the amount of regulation that is coming our way.
And of course, the reason why we're talking about regulations is because you have a fantastic and really excitingly titled presentation coming up at Risk Minds in Focus, where you'll be talking about the link between regulation and organizational success. So, is there any
Survival, actually, not even success. Sorry to
survival?
interrupt.
So, is there a link between them?
It is, and you'd be surprised that the link is that there is no real link between the number of regulations being proposed and organizational survival. Let me take you back a little bit in time. In 2007, the UK had its biggest bankruptcy in over 150 years. A run on the bank that had not been seen for the last 150 years. And I'm talking, of course, about Northern Rock. Now, Northern Rock had reported problems in March, April. And I believe in the second half of September 2007, they declared themselves unable to make salary payments. And there was a run on the bank at that time. And just after Valentine's Day 2008, ironically, they declared themselves bankrupt. This was a time when the global financial crisis was being played out. And regulators were already on guard to avoid systemic collapses. And I would call Northern Rock a systemic collapse because it did not have any exposure to the subprime markets in the United States. Its loan book was actually very, very good compared to the rest of the competitors. And so they did not deserve to go down the way they did. But they did. They did go down. And the reason was very simple. The number of regulations that were enacted had absolutely nothing whatsoever to do with organizational survival. And that has played out consistently, not just in this country, but around the world. If you take a look at Merrill Lynch or AIG or Lehman, all the big names, including some of the regulatory big names in the United States, it essentially tells you that regulatory anticipation and heightened regulation has actually got nothing to do with organizational survival unless there is some kind of direct guarantee that is proposed by the regulator to say that, look, if you were to fall by the wayside because of your own stupidity, we're not going to lift a finger. And that's perfectly acceptable. But if there is a systemic problem which affects not just one bank or two banks, but all the banks in the ecosystem, we will be there to help you overcome the issues at hand. And that message is not coming through, unfortunately. And so my article argues that the link that exists is no link.
That makes sense. In my mind, I was just imagining this sort of camel hump sort of, number of regulations versus survival rate of banks, essentially. But that's not the case. Is that what you're saying?
If you look at, the UK is blessed in the sense that there have not been that many instances of defaults. The US, where there were a lot more organizations defaulting after the global financial crisis. And again, if you see my blog, I can see very clearly that the US takes a lead in actually the number of regulations being proposed now as it did then. And so it's therefore logical to draw a kind of inverse correlation between the fact that the number of regulations is on the increase. There is no decrease in the number of defaults. The number of defaults also increase. And so there is a direct correlation between number of regulations being proposed and number of defaults, as was the case in the global financial crisis. I'm afraid that it'll be the same now as well.
Suresh, thank you so much for joining me today and for sharing this piece of information.
My pleasure, Lily. Thank you very, very much.